In late September, Prairie Public's camera crews spent 3 days in the Washington, D.C. offices of North Dakota's U.S. Senator Byron Dorgan. We are gathering material for a Prairie Public documentary that will air in January of 2011. It will show what represents a typical day in the life of a U.S. senator. As part of our visit, we had a conversation with Senator Byron Dorgan.
The purpose of us coming to Washington, D.C. was to spend a couple days with you and hopefully give people an idea of what happens to a senator when he's in Washington, D.C. and all the variety of tasks. As we've been with you for the past 2 days, we're out of breath. The amount of activity.
I don't think so.
The amount of activity that you've been involved in has just been amazing. On a typical day, is this what you do? You have meetings, you go to the Senate, you vote. Is this a typical day for you?
Pretty much. I mean, I normally leave 7 or 7:15 in the morning, get home around 7 or 7:30. So it's usually a 12-hour day, and then I almost every day take a big packet of materials home. Life here is very busy because there are so many people coming in from North Dakota. They all want to come and have a visit, which is very important, and I'm really pleased that we are able to do that. But you have to fit all of that into, in many cases, 15-minute segments between hearings and things on the floor and caucus meetings and speeches and television appearances and all the things that you do in a typical day. So it's a busy life, it is.
And then on top of that, all of a sudden these votes come up and everything just seems to have to change.
The votes come up and then a lot of telephone calls pile up. You know, people will call and you get 4, 5, 6, in some cases 10 telephone messages. I very often make a lot of telephone calls at 6 or 7 in the evening on the way back home after a work day. But the problem is I can't use it in the morning because it's, you know, in western North Dakota, when I'm driving in, it's, 5 in the morning or 6 in the morning in eastern North Dakota. So I do a lot of telephone return calls in the evening when I'm driving home.
It looks like you have a great opportunity to stay in shape because you're in the office, you're running over to the Capitol. And then you also play tennis, don't you?
Well, I don't play as much as I'd like to these days. I run. I mean, I get up at 6 in the morning, and I try 3 to 4 days a week to run about 2.5 miles. You know, I'm not a big runner, but I run a 2.5 mile route. I try to do that, if I can, 4 days a week, and I usually do that early in the morning, 6 in the morning.
As we followed you with cameras, we noticed you're quite a fast walker as well.
I've always been a very fast walker, but you know, that also is good exercise, but it's just, that's my natural gait. I want to get from here to there in minimum time, and there is a lot of walking here because you're back and forth to a lot of meetings and back and forth to the Capitol building, and my staff always complains to me because I walk way too fast.
What about the paperwork? You have some paper on your desk now. You mentioned that you take some stuff home. Is there a huge volume of paperwork that you have to deal with?
Massive volume of paperwork. And part of it is the ability to digest it all, because during the day there's not very much time to pick something up and read it and think about it and evaluate it. And so most of that is for me late in the evening. And I take really, and most senators I think do, take big batches of paper for the evening and evening reading. And then what a lot of people I think miss and don't understand that in many cases these jobs are 7 days a week. In long hours. And when I'm in North Dakota, I travel, somewhere around 30 trips a year to North Dakota back and forth, many of them weekends. And when I'm in North Dakota, I travel a lot because I'm trying to, cover the whole state. And so there's a lot of, in addition to the things you have seen here, there's a lot of travel. And the travel part gets a little bit old.
You really seem to have to bounce back and forth between a variety of things on the spur of the moment. Things are coming at you out of the clear blue sky, it seems like, all the time.
It's just the way this business is. I think it's that way for everybody. But if you're, we work on a lot of things. I mean, right now, today, I'm working on something that has nothing to do with North Dakota, but it has a tangential connection, the issue of Cuba. If New York Philharmonic wants to perform in Havana, Cuba, and they came to me, and they're trying to get a license from the Treasury Department to allow them to travel. And the Treasury Department, is being very bureaucratic, and so I met with the conductor of the Philharmonic, and so I've been on the phone today with Treasury, and I'm trying to get that resolved. And it's not like a farm problem in North Dakota or working with businesses as we often do, but you know, the New York Philharmonic is America's great symphony. They've performed in North Korea, they've performed in Russia. I think it'd be wonderful if they could perform in Havana, Cuba. So, you know, it's just one example of a little thing today I've been working on. But there are a dozen or two dozen exactly like that, that you try to fit in between the crevices of all the other things you're doing.
I once heard you talk about the special desk you have in the Senate chamber and the history of that desk. Can you tell us a little about that?
The Senate desks have great history, and in fact, when I was sworn in, I sat at a temporary desk, and I opened the drawer. You carve your name inside the desk. It's been that way for a couple hundred years. And I opened the drawer and saw Harry S. Truman. I thought, man, I mean, from a high school class of nine in a small Regent, North Dakota high school, now I have a desk in the United States Senate previously occupied by Harry Truman. That's a pretty big deal. And so then I got the permanent desk 2 weeks later that has been my desk, and I opened the drawer to see whose it was, and I saw all these names, and I saw Robert La Follette, the great populist senator from Wisconsin. And so I said to Senator Byrd, the oldest senator, the real historian, knows all the history, and now departed, of course, but I said, you know whose desk I've got? I've got Robert La Follette's desk, the great populist senator from Wisconsin. He said, oh, really? Do you know they tried to kill him at that desk? And I said, no. He said, absolutely. So I wrote to the Library of Congress. I said, do you have any information about somebody trying to kill Robert La Follette? And from what I could understand, the information I got back, May 29th, 1908, it's a little over a century ago, he was on his feet doing a filibuster, and he sent a page, which is a young student that works in the Senate, a Senate page down to get a turkey sandwich and a glass of milk. And they brought it up. You have to stand on your feet during a filibuster. He'd been speaking 6 hours or so, and he took a little nibble of his turkey sandwich, and then a sip of his milk, and spit it out and started screaming he'd been poisoned. And because he didn't drink it, of course, he wasn't injured. But they sent it away to a laboratory, and they discovered that something was in there that would have done him in. So they never quite figured out how that happened or why it happened. So, but Senator Byrd really whetted my appetite for the history of Senate desks. And so I've often told high school groups the history of the Senate through the desks. Just across from my desk is the desk always occupied by a Mississippi senator. And in about 1860, Jefferson Davis stood up at that desk and gave the secession speech, and then walked out of the Senate chamber, and other Southern senators followed him, and we were at war. And he became president of the Confederacy, and a Union soldier came to the Senate about 3-4 months later, and after the Senate had adjourned, they were touring or something, and he asked, where was Jefferson Davis's desk? He was so angry. And they said it was right over there. And he walked over and he drew his bayonet, and he rammed his bayonet through this cherry wood desk. And if we could go there right now, I'd show you Senator Thad Cochran's desk with the little patch holes of the bayonet from 1860, a Union soldier. Or just behind me and down about four desks is Robert Kennedy's desk. But before Robert Kennedy sat there, John F. Kennedy sat there. And after Robert Kennedy sat there, Teddy Kennedy sat there. The Kennedy brothers' desk, three Kennedy brothers. And you know, there's such great history. And as you can tell, I love history and love the history of the Senate. It's America's longest answer, by the way, to a question.
What are the one or two things that you think you've done that might have really made an impact, the things you're proudest of?
Oh, people ask me that, and it's very hard to condense this to a thing, to one piece of legislation. You know, I think when I'm gone from the Senate and on to other chapters of my life, and people look back in the rearview mirror 10 years from now, I think people will see in North Dakota the creation that I created, the Red River Valley Research Corridor, world-class cutting-edge research that is attracting not only new startup companies in our region, but also companies that are coming to our region to co-locate near world-class research. I think that is going to make a profound difference. It already is, but it's just the foundation. And I had this notion that why should we send our best and brightest kids from our best schools to go to Denver and Los Angeles and Dallas and New York and, you know, to work in these companies where you have a hierarchy and a career ladder and do cutting edge research? Why don't we do that here in North Dakota? And allow these best and brightest to become part of our future? And so I've steered as an appropriator over $800 million now to create world-class cutting-edge research, and people come to see what we're doing and it is jaw-dropping for them. They had no idea. And now, for example, the Milken Institute says we're one of the fastest growing areas in America in this research. National Science Foundation says we're one of the fastest growing areas. Pick up Inc. magazine, that's the place to watch, the Red River Valley Research Corridor. Or pick up Delta Airlines magazine, the Red River Valley Research Corridor. We're building something really substantial. And it just came from an idea I had. Why not build it here? Why not create something here in North Dakota? And I couldn't be more pleased with what we've done. And I think it's just a start.
We've been very impressed with your staff here. Why don't you talk a little bit about your staff and your feelings towards the staff? Tell us about your staff.
The fact is, those of us in public service, in public life who are elected, we take all the bows to the extent that there are successes. But there are people who work for us if you select well, and I certainly have, I think, done that. I've got some just outstanding people that work for me and work with me, not so much for me. And they work long hours, weekends, travel. If people would know, they would be mightily impressed with these folks. I have a great staff. And the one regret I have is not about leaving the Senate. I chose to leave after 30 years because I want another chapter in my life, and I would have had to make a commitment for 7 more years this year through a campaign and 6 more. And I just felt that's not what I want to do. I've done this 40 years and 10 years in the state capitol, 12 years in the U.S. House, 18 years in the U.S. Senate. I still feel fairly young and I have a lot yet to do, but the only opportunity to do that is with the route that I've taken. But the one regret I have really is to break up an unbelievably talented staff. I mean, they are friends. I really love the staff I've been able to put together. Love working with them every day.
The schedulers have a tough time though. As we were here this week, we just see them having the telephone calls come in. You're in a meeting and all of a sudden you have to change gears.
It's a very difficult time. I have, Christy does scheduling up until the day, and then I have a scheduler that helps run the day. But we have, because I chair a good number of committees and subcommittees, we have around 80% of the requests for meetings are requests that we can't honor. Just don't have time. And so, I mean, all North Dakotans, when they come to town, North Dakotans come to town, they have priority. They always get a meeting. That's the priorities, meeting with North Dakotans. But we have so many other requests that we just can't accommodate. We put as many as we can in a day, always in 15-minute increments. And, you do as much as you can, but there are about 80% of the requests from around the country to come in for a meeting that we can't accommodate. But that never applies to North Dakotans, because it's fun over the years to see all these North Dakotans. Many of them come in year after year on the same issues.
You must have a couple things that you really want to get done before January 1st. What are the things that you're really pushing for right now?
Well, right now, today, I was working on what is called a renewable electricity standard, requiring that all electricity that's delivered in this country have a 15% component of renewables, wind, solar, and so on, biomass. And the reason I feel strongly about that is driving the issue of maximizing renewable energy to make us less dependent on foreign oil. I mean, that's a very big issue. I'm working on a lot of other issues. I have a bill that is called the Dorgan-Alexander, I'm the lead sponsor, on an electric car deployment bill. We're moving towards electric vehicles. We need to be number one in the world in battery technology. We need to develop a 500-mile battery. And I put $2 billion of grant funds and then addition on top of that loan funds in the Economic Recovery Act and my appropriations bill. And we're now seeing massive new research on battery technology. And we're seeing for the first time people opening up new plants to manufacture new technology batteries. I talked to the CEO of the first one to do it in Michigan, opening a very large plant to manufacture new technology batteries. Because you've got to have that in order to convert to the electric car industry. But there's a lot of things going on that I'm working on. I'm also working on eliminating the travel restrictions on the American people to Cuba. We can go to North Korea, we can go to Iran, we can go to Communist China, Communist Vietnam. And because 50 years ago, Fidel Castro kept poking his finger in our eye. We decided to punish Fidel Castro by punishing the American people and saying to the American people, you can't travel to Cuba. I think that's nuts. Best way to get rid of the Castro brothers is through trade and travel. I want the Cuban people to hear more voices than the Castro regime. And so I'm trying to get rid of the travel restriction to Cuba. I mean, but I'm working on about 8 or 10 things, water policy issues that need to be done by the end of the year. So I've got plenty on my plate.
I've heard you talk about North Dakota as an energy state. Why don't you tell us a little bit about your ideas about North Dakota and energy in the future of North Dakota?
Well, I think energy is going to be a significant part of the country's future economic challenges in terms of economic security and energy security. North Dakota is now a major producer of oil, fourth in the nation. Most people don't know that. We're an oil state. We produce oil, natural gas, we produce wind and coal and biomass. We produce virtually, and ethanol, the biofuels. We produce virtually every kind of energy. The thing is, we're far from markets, and we don't need all that energy. So we're producing for others. The conveyance is what's the problem, transmission and pipelines. And we've got problems in both. You've got to have a pipeline to put oil and natural gas, and you've got to move it to where it's needed. And you also need electric wires to move all this electricity we produce to where it's needed at the load centers. We can only maximize electricity from wind in North Dakota, and North Dakota is an unbelievably windy state, number one in the nation in wind. 50th in trees and first in wind, I say. And so we can only accommodate what we need to do there is if we build the modern transmission grid. The problems with that are pricing, planning, and siting. And we've built 11,000 miles of natural gas pipeline in the last 10 years and only 680 miles of high voltage interstate transmission. Why? Because you've got a dozen jurisdictions that can say no and always do. So I've written a transmission piece that I want to get done as well that gives FERC backstop authority. It says you're all involved in planning, pricing, and siting, but if you can't get it done, we have FERC backstop authority to site it. And we need to build the interstate transmission capability if we're going to maximize the production of energy in North Dakota for the rest of the country.
After January 1st, what are a few of the things you have lined up that you're going to do?
Well, the center of what I'm going to do, I can't make decisions about because of the ethics issues in Congress. And I have always cared about making sure not just that I'm on the right side of the line, but I stay way away from the line. I think it's very important for people to believe that they've got someone in public service that they can count on and trust and is honest. And so, you know, I will decide that next chapter beginning in January when it's appropriate to do so. I'm doing a couple things. The one thing I can do by rule here in the Congress is sign a book contract. I've written two books, and I'm proud, a kid from a high school class of 9 in Regent. It was on the New York Times extended bestseller list for 6 weeks. So proud of that. I've written two books, and I signed a contract last month to write two more books over the next 3 years. And I love to write, and a publisher is very interested in having me do some books for them. So I'm going to do that. I'm also intending to create at the University of North Dakota a Center for Advanced Energy Policy Studies. And that center, the Institute for Advanced Energy Policy Studies, is something I'm creating working with the president of the University of North Dakota. I've been able to get some funding to do that. I think it's very important. If you're going to be a big energy state, then you need an intellectual framework for energy studies someplace in the state. University of North Dakota is a good place to do that. And I'm also going to create a foundation dealing with Native American youths at risk. I'm chairman of the Indian Affairs Committee, and I've spent a lot of time working on teenage Indian suicide prevention, which is in some cases 10 times the national average. Nationally, it's 3.5 times the national average. And it just breaks my heart. I mean, I've held hearing after hearing on it, and I want to continue to work to try to do something to see if I can save some lives and help some kids. So those are several things I'm doing, but they're not the center of what I'll be doing.
Yeah. You ever thought about teaching?
Yes. I have taught previously, and I may well do some of that. The answer is yes. I've previously taught some economics when I was a statewide elected official at a college in Bismarck. So I have been in the classroom as an instructor and teacher, professor. But I likely will do some, and I've had some contact, although not detailed, with some interests that would like me to teach a class. And I probably will end up doing something like that as well.
Do you see any books in the future, a history book?
I don't know. The two I'm writing will not be that, but I have in mind another book that is a bit different. It's a book about a tragedy that occurred at the end of the Second World War. My uncle was killed on a ship called the Leopoldville that was sunk on Christmas Eve, 1944, 5 miles from the harbor in Cherbourg, France. In fact, I was there about 6-8 weeks ago. And roughly 780 soldiers died that night on Christmas Eve. And no one knew it because the American government, the British government, and the Belgian government, it was a Belgian ship, decided it would have been too devastating to American morale to hear that 700 soldiers died that night crossing the English Channel 5 miles from the harbor, sunk by a U-boat, torpedo from a German U-boat. And so it was covered up for 40 years, and no one knew. It was all missing in action, but no one knew of the tragedy. And I'd like to write a book about it. As I said, I've traveled there, and I've spoken to some soldiers that survived that night. So that may be a book I'd like to do when I get some time after the next two books.
How about travel? Do you feel like doing some travel?
I love to travel. I've been around most of the world. I haven't been to Southern Africa, which I intend to do, but I love to travel.
How, over these years, with all of the public service you've done, how do you carve out time for your family?
That's another reason I think it's important to find the right time for you to transition to other things. You know, my daughter Haley is now a senior in college, and so our children are gone. But it's hard when you take 30 weekends a year and travel during the weekends. Effectively, you're working 7 days a week. It's really you do have to find ways to make time for the family. And I've really tried very hard to do that. I've missed boats from time to time to go see a puppet show in grade school because I knew that no one would remember the boat I missed, but my daughter would remember that her dad wasn't there. And I mean, you make those choices sometimes, but it's hard. I mean, I lost a beautiful daughter in the middle of this to heart surgery, and you know, even then I wondered. It's such a devastating blow. I even then wondered whether I was going to be able to continue to do this. And I mean, I got through that, but boy, it's, you know, family is just, if you don't pay attention, you've got to, in a life like this, as busy and as difficult and complex a life it is in public service, you've got to spend time and make time for family.
Yeah, losing a child must be the worst feeling in the world.
My daughter died when I was in the Senate, and it was very unexpected, and I couldn't talk about it for the longest time, but I went through a period that was, you know, you're just not sure you want to continue doing things the way you did them. And yet she was very proud of this, and you know, was very interested in politics, and she would have made a good politician herself, frankly. She was a wonderful, wonderful young woman.
What are you going to miss the most?
I don't know, because I'm not on the other side in a new chapter of my life at this point, but I think you develop a muscle memory of working long hours every day with the attention span that switches every 5 minutes. So I think you have to change kind of your notion of how you're going to handle your days. The really most important thing to me is I'll miss a lot of wonderful staff that I've worked with, and I'll miss I intend to continue to be very involved in North Dakota, and I'll see a lot of my friends as I continue to travel some in North Dakota, but I won't be traveling the way I used to in the state, and so I'll miss a lot of that as well.
Do you plan to spend time both in Washington, D.C. and
mm-hmm.
North Dakota?
I do.
This is your opportunity now. We're at the end. Is there anything that you'd like to tell us?
No, it's just that people say to me that they say thank you, and I say no, I should say thank you. I mean, this has been a great privilege and a gift to me, given me by the people of North Dakota. So I don't think I've ever taken this for granted. I mean, I've always thought this was a great privilege, and I still, on my wall, I've got my lineage. I've got where I came from. I never forget that. I love to go back to my little hometown and And you know, I've always recognized as well that you've got to have passion in your heart about the things you believe in and do what you believe is right. I mean, I've had very difficult votes from time to time that have, you know, the example, voting on changing the Constitution to prohibit desecrating the American flag. I love the American flag, but I would never change the Constitution with a flag burning amendment. And I know people get very upset because I wouldn't vote for that. I just, you know, I think the Constitution has been amended only 17 times in 200 years. And we've got people that think it's a rough draft. Every urge they get, they want to amend the Constitution. I just can't do it, no matter what people think. I've got, you know, and so I've done what I've tried to do and then be passionate to say to people, here's how I felt about it. But the final point is that this has been a great gift given me by the people in North Dakota. And this tent of our democracy and government doesn't rest on a center pole called Byron Dorgan. There are a lot of good people and will be a lot of good people in the future who assume the mantle of responsibility for elected office, and this gives me the opportunity to move off to another chapter of my life.
Thank you, Senator.
Thank you very much.